very, very difficult to get access to the prison. Actually, we kind of got lucky, I think, because the IG of prisons at that time was a poet.
Oh, I see.
And he encouraged these people to write poetry. So, and the, one of the research officer who was there was an ex-student of ours. So we went through him and we told him that, look, we want to make a film about poetry, prison and poetry. So he gave us access. Of course, inside the prison, some of the people were not very happy that we had access, but they, since we had the IG's permission, particularly the gallows and all that, they were not very keen on allowing us to shoot. And of course, throughout there was, they gave somebody to kind of supervise us, but that fellow was not interested. So, you know, I mean, I don't think it made a difference. So people were, the prisoners were quite articulate. They didn't, that chap who was detailed to keep an eye on us would go around, sit in some corners. So, so in that sense, and actually we had a very, very short period of time. So we had, I think it was six days or seven days in the prison. And within that period, we had to do everything, you know, finish the film. So it was just short of that, and then we, it was a very intense experience. So we had made one trip earlier for a day and where we met the prisoners and we spoke to them and asked them whether they would like to be a part of the film. And then after that we had this 6-day shooting and that was it, because it's not a easy to go and come and go and come. And then of course after making the film we took it back to them. So they were the first people to see the film and approve of the film before we released it.
There was any censor or anybody no. supervised no. after the editing?
No.
No.
If you look back, it was a life-changing experience being with the, you know, inside. Because it's a, and I, two stories are two anecdotes that I want to say. That one is that when I, when we met Harrison for the first time, he first told us that he will give us an interview, but then he kept on avoiding us, you know, all throughout the film. So then I was, on the last day, I was asked, I mean, they all said, why don't you go and speak to him? So I went to his cell and I asked him, I mean, he was, I said, will you do this film? And he was eating his, it was lunch, and it is, you know, they eat this ground corn, which is Nigerian food, and corn, and lady's finger, okra. So he offered his food and I said, no, I don't want this food. I mean, I said, I have had my lunch already. So he said, do you know that something like this food exists in India? So I said, yes, it actually looks like uppam, you know, the whatever they're eating. So he suddenly kind of cottoned on, he said, but how do you know that word? Are you from South India? He's asked me. He said, yes, I am from South India. So he was completely, his attitude completely changed. He has spent much of his time in Chennai as a student. And he had a very warm, and very good experience in Chennai. He said, you're a South Indian and we are same culture, you know, South Indian and African, I'm going to give you the interview. So that was how he kind of connected with it. Very interesting, very intense experience. So then he came, then I told him, why don't you speak about your reluctance? So, you know, you saw how he starts, he said, I've become allergic to the camera. So he said, you, that's how he started his interview. But what is the most significant, which is very, very heartening in the film, is that when we went back to screen this film, he was he gave us a piece of paper which said his the lawyer of the co-accused lawyer and his telephone number. He said he was arrested in 1986 on an NDPS charge, and which would have fetched him 10 years. Means he would have given, if you had convicted, he would have become, he would have been released in 1996, but he was there still 97. So he said, can you do something about it? I said,
he had been acquitted by,
he was acquitted by the court.
Court, but the state went on appeal.
And
so
the
his case was pending for 11 years.
So we went to the accused lawyer and we collected this 1600 pages of paper. And then, and that lawyer is not really interested in the case at all. And then we took it to another friend of ours, whose another friend kind of appeared for him in the court in 1998. And you'd be shocked, he was acquitted in 1998. Acquitted. That's all the small
things. After spending 12 years in
the jail. 12 years in the jail. So then he used to come then he used to come for all the screenings of this film. He would say, "You are my foster parents." It was my and he was so that. I mean, we did nothing, but he was. It was changed his life, you know. And then he used to come for all the screenings. So, I mean, it also speaks about the judicial system in the country. How badly hung. I mean, I don't want to say anything because I will be condemned of court. But that's how the system works.
This is generic.
I know. I'm just joking. That was a, and of course also Mathwala, who's also used this film as a document when he appealed to the president to release him.
Mercy petition.
Of course, if you see the film, you would know that he's a wise man and, you know, he should be let off. So he actually was released, and he was sent back to Italy. I mean, he went back to Europe. We are still in touch with him. He wants to come back to India, but it's difficult for him to. He lives in Amsterdam. And, you know, the stigma is so much. So, for example, somebody Googled him, and when he applied for a job, he found that he was in the jail. His picture was in there somewhere of this film still. And then he was denied a job. You know, so it kind of continues even after so many years.
So the film is, film is working after the film.
Yeah. I mean, not very often that can you tell story of like this, you know, which I, you know, some.
Two interventions they have done, and, you know, like one person got acquitted and one person got, you know, like.
So that's more important than the film itself.
But for many years after, of course, Mathwala we are still in touch with, but even the other prisoners, for many years we were in touch with them, and even from the prison they would write to us. And we helped somebody to get a scholarship to do his MA. And so for quite a few, then of course now it's 20 years we kind of lost touch with all of them except for Mathwala, who still writes to us. And
about the exposure to poetry, this was in several different languages. They had a library, there's a small shot of a library. Do they have exposure to poetry in prison?
I don't think, I mean, I don't know what was the collection in that library, but I don't think that much of exposure to poetry, probably their own kind of. I don't know. I don't know whether you're asking whether they're.
It's a musical. The sound. It sounded very musical. You know,
yeah.
I imagine that it's difficult to produce that kind of poetry.
Yeah.
Unless you're exposed to a lot of poetry on your own.
Yeah, they do read. Some of them do read.
Particularly that Ghanshyam, the first Hindi poet who came, he used to write poetry before also. I mean, he was all. He sort of considered himself as a poet, but many of the others had never written poetry until they came to
the Marathi poet.
He didn't know poetry. Most of them were not exposed to poetry, but in some way I think that experience of crisis sort of either makes you or breaks you. It kind of transforms you in a way that it opens out things within you that you never knew existed. And
you asked about whether they are forced to work. Compelled to work. They are not compelled to work, it's like a factory. Okay. They have to do, they get paid for it.
But if they don't work, then they don't have money.
They don't have money.
If they want to buy even soap or toothpaste or something,
so they make
or even tea or anything, unless they work, they will not.
Now, Mathwala is writing braille books. You know, you saw him doing that, he's writing, making braille books. Somebody is doing weaving, somebody is doing all kinds of things that they do today.
And they get paid very, very little for it. Whatever they do, it's like paltry, a few rupees.
Some of them speak about just taking out their into their horrible world, whether their own sorrows and their longing for their family. Did any of them? Because I'm asking you because I've had some little experience going to women's prisons. Mm-hmm. I was chairperson of the Women's Commission here. So at that time I used to visit women's prisons. That was one of the things I'd taken up, and the major prisons in Tamil Nadu I had visited. The moment I got into any one of those prisons, you find women just breaking out. Many of them had been arrested for very petty thefts or mostly for illicit liquor brewing. No, almost all of them came from most wretched parts of our society. Many of them were Dalits, and many of them were, they were all very, very, very poor. So, did you have such experiences where people were breaking down, telling you they were innocent, or even regretting what they have done? Did you have all that? I thought the minute you get into the into a prison, that is what first happens when they meet an outsider who has come not as an officer, but as somebody else who they think would empathize. So that was my very hard, it was an unbearable experience for me every time I went to the prison. But I kept on going back and back to many of the prisons. So I'm just wondering whether you had such a feeling.
Yeah, I guess with men it might be a little different, though some of them do speak about them breaking down, but I don't know whether, you know, they would break down in front of a camera. But yes, definitely that undercurrent is very, very much there, the pain, the pathos, and we've sort of, it comes out through the poetry, it comes out through the things they say, and also so for many of them, for instance, I was the only woman in the crew, and for many of them, they were seeing a woman like after 6 years or 10 years, or because there's no other.
Yes.
In fact, when you go into the prison, they give you a token, which you're supposed to give them when you come out, and then I said, "Where's my token?" They didn't give me. I said, "No, you don't need a token. There's nobody of your kind here, so." I mean, you can't kind of, you know, get lost in this place. You have to come up. So that was very much there. And of course, there were some things that people said on camera that we decided not to put into the film. So for instance, if they talked about the conditions in the prison, the bad conditions in the prison, we did not want to put that in the film because it would compromise their safety in the prison. So we didn't want to put in anything into the film that would make it difficult, because they were still in the prison. We didn't want to put in those kind of things. So we didn't want it to make it a film about how bad the prison is, pathetic it is, but how does the human spirit handle a space like a prison in a kind of, how does it transcend that space of the prison? I think that was
there was no censorship by the prison authorities, you are no questioning of it. Well, many of them also said that, you know, we don't want to speak to you now, because they realize also it is dangerous for them to speak. But one thing that I want to stress is that, you know, a prison is, I mean, you've seen it, but mostly our ideas of a prison is of very dirty and horrible. Actually, it's a very clean place, but at the same time, very oppressive place. I mean, they keep it clean. We've seen very beautiful looking. In fact, some of the officers told us that you shouldn't be shooting here because jail works because of deterrent, that it's a terrible place. So you take out these beautiful pictures outside, people say jail is a good place to go to. Yeah. So they were not very happy that they're taking pictures. It actually looks very beautiful because it's a old, you know, it's a Gothic structure, you know, like one of the European. Yeah, you saw this. Yeah. It's not that it is, does only some parts look, everything looks, you know, every part looks clean. But it's very oppressive, extremely.